Hi everyone, good evening. Welcome to An Academy CAT for MBA and welcome to this live session. So this session we are going to have a vocabulary quiz. Okay, so guys, we've already had a lot of vocabulary sessions in which we've talked about vocabulary question types like synonyms, antonyms. We have talked about idioms, like the important idioms that you can study for your exams, and I have explained their meanings in detail and with examples. So that has also happened already. So we have also talked about, you know, words which are similar, words that you can often get confused into. And we have also talked about words that have come into English from foreign languages and, root words and how do you remember those words. So this is something that has already happened. And after that, we also had a series of, you know, live sessions related to grammatical topics. So I thought before we start talking about RCs and verbal reasoning, it would be a good idea to conduct a quick vocabulary quiz so that we get to know how much we remember. And overall, we'll also sort of assess our preparation related to vocabulary. Now, I think most of you know that. Hi, Nicole. Good evening. So, yeah. So, as you know, as far as CAT is concerned, we have not had, questions related to vocabulary directly. So, questions like synonyms, antonyms, or fill in the blanks have not been there in CAT. But when we talk about all the other exams, so when we talk about ZAT, MAT, SNAP specifically, people who are preparing for SNAP and want to crack SNAP should particularly focus on vocabulary as far as verbal ability section is concerned. So for all the other exams, vocabulary is really very important, and that is why this quick quiz with vocabulary. So let's see how we go about it. Hi, Nicole. How have you been? How's your preparation going? Okay, so I guess we'll start. So before we start, I think all of you know about me already, but still a very quick introduction. So my name is Apurva Deshpande. I have completed my master's in English and I've been teaching English for over 7 years now. And I've also qualified some exams conducted by the University of Cambridge. All right. And so today's agenda, as I said, is going to be a vocabulary quiz. So we are going to take a look at, so we will be solving approximately 30 questions in which we will solve questions on synonyms, antonyms, and then idioms. Okay. And some of these words and some of these idioms were there when we discussed them for the first time, but most of them are new. So overall, you might have seen them in passages or, you know, in movies. So let's see if you know the meaning correctly. And so helpful, this is going to be quite a useful session. All right. So before we start with the session, I hope all of you have subscribed to our YouTube channel. If not, please quickly subscribe to An Academy CAT for MBA on YouTube. And please join our Telegram group at CAT for MBA. Both these sources are going to be very helpful when we talk about your MBA entrance test prep. Okay, apart from that, I have also suggested all of you to take up the An Academy Plus subscription. That's going to be crucial, guys. So please take up the Plus subscription. There are already two deals that are highlighted for you. So you can go for the 1 year plan, which comes at 15,750 rupees, or the 2 year plan, which is offered to you at 18,900 rupees. And plus, if you use my code Apurva, you will get a further 10% off. So a very attractive deal, and don't miss it. Okay, so let's start with our session for today. Let's start talking about vocabulary. So the first 10 questions that we are going to solve are based on synonyms. Okay, so here's the first question, guys. The word is stentorian. So do you know this word? Any idea what this means? Nicole? So I'll just tell you this particular word, and then perhaps you can tell me what, you know, synonym would be, what word would be the correct answer. So, you know, a loud or very powerful voice or sound is a stentorian voice. So we're looking for a synonym, right? So see, rhythmic cannot be the answer because we're talking about something which is very loud or powerful. This word is often used to describe a roar, you know, a lion's roar, which is like stentorian, very powerful, very loud. Okay, then the second word, when we say euphonious, it means a pleasant sound. Okay, quite close to the word mellifluous. So mellifluous also means something which is very soothing or sweet, okay, sound. So euphonious is a pleasant sound. Hi Nivedita, good evening, how are you? Then blaring also means you know, quite loud and harsh sound. Often, you know, if you've heard the siren that an ambulance has, so that particular sound is described as a blaring sound, quite harsh and loud, for the right reasons, of course, because it has to get at the attention of people. So that is blaring. And subdue is basically to overcome something. It's a verb to overcome something. So now you tell me which option is correct. Nicole, which option? So yeah, it will be option C. It's quite apparent. Okay, so see, because we are talking about now, stentorian is related to sound, correct, Nicole? Yeah. And even the first two words are related to sound, but they have different meanings. So they don't essentially have the meaning of being a loud or powerful voice or sound. Okay, so that's why we'll not go for A or B. The correct option will be option C. Great. Now the second word that we have is voracious. All right. So voracious is somebody that somebody who is speaking the truth. So, which option? Now, this is going to be quite simple. Second one. Speaking the truth. So, it's option D. Truthful. Right? So, this one actually could be an antonym. Okay, the others are not related. So voracious, the synonym is truthful. Correct, Nivedita. Correct, Nicole. Well done. Now the third option is perturb, and perturb means to, you know, worry someone, to make someone worried, to make someone anxious. So what can it be? So, for example, I can say my brother did not come home until late night, so that perturbed the entire family. So, it worried the entire family. So, look at the options. I'll tell you what stipulate means, okay? So, stipulate is to demand or specify something. So, for example, it's C, correct. Nicole and Nivedita, both your answers are absolutely correct. Well done. It is disturb. So stipulate is used when, you know, you want something to be done, but you want it to be done in a very specified way. Like when you give very specific instructions, you can say it's a stipulated program, you know, like demanding certain things to be done in a certain way. All right. So here are the first three words that we looked at, guys. The first one was stentorian. Stentorian means a loud voice. Okay, a loud sound. Remember, a stentorian roar. Veracious was the second word. Veracious is somebody who's like, you know, speaking the truth, truthful. And perturb means to make somebody anxious or to make somebody worried, right? So these three words are clear, fixed. Let's talk about the next three words. Here's the first one, invigorate. You know, this is something, guys, if you know, a part of this word, you'll be able to figure out the meaning. Invigorate, there's a word, so vigor. Do you know what vigor means? What is vigor? Enthusiasm, Nicole, absolutely correct. So, vigor is energy or enthusiasm. So, invigorate basically means to give energy to something. Okay, to refresh something, to energize something. Now, how can we use it? I can say, you know, when I came home from work, I had a cup of hot coffee that invigorated me. So, that gave me energy, that refreshed me. Okay, so that's how you can use it in a sentence. Now, tell me an option which is absolutely not possible. You're not considering it at all. So, if you're saying invigorate is basically to give energy or to re-energize something, tire is gone, reprise is gone. Reprise is basically to repeat. You know, often used for music, when a piece of music is repeated, so that is reprise, so this is gone. So we are now, but you know, we are confused between these two options. So we have galvanized and we have dilapidated. So dilapidated is, you know, in a very poor condition. So if you say that the buildings are dilapidated, that means they are in a very bad condition, very poor condition. So this is also not correct. So, the synonym is galvanize. Now, galvanize doesn't exactly have the same meaning of giving energy to somebody. Galvanize is basically used to, you know, talk about when you make somebody take an action. Okay, often by shocking them, you know, for example, I can say the committee was galvanized to, you know, do something about it, to make somebody take an action about something. Right. Let's talk about the next word. The next word is unctuous. So unctuous is to, you know, it's basically used for behavior where people have too much praise. So when you have, you know, there are certain people who, you know, flatter people or they praise people too much because they want to gain an advantage out of it, right? So such behavior is called unctuous behavior, something which is not sincere and something that includes too much praise, and you know, you get to know that this is not real. So which option do you think it will be? Question number 5, answer quickly guys. So, see, it cannot be authentic. So, if I'm saying that, you know, when we say unctuous is basically too much praise, which is often not real. Authentic is definitely not the answer. Vendetta, have you heard this word before? It basically means revenge. Okay. So, often when you have, you know, this is something that you often see in Bollywood movies, even in Hollywood, where there is a very long, sort of long-lasting fight going on between two families or two people. And because one person has done something wrong, now the other person will do something wrong to avenge what has happened. So, that is vendetta. Okay, so that's also not possible. And this option, grovel, has two meanings. One meaning is crawl. So, you know, when you move closely towards something, that is also grovel. And the other meaning is also to write something, you know, when you want to apologize to somebody, when you want to be extremely polite, okay, and you write a groveling note, that is also possible. The correct answer here is this one, okay, sycophantic. So, sycophantic actually mean behavior that is intended to gain advantage. Got it? So that's the correct answer, guys. Right. Let's talk about the next one. Now, this is something that you will be able to answer. So I'll just tell you the meaning of fervent. So fervent is intense or strong. you know, passionate. That is the meaning of fervent. So when you say I'm a fervent supporter of something, yeah. So fervent, what do you think? Can it be reluctant? Reluctant is unwilling, right? When you don't want to do something, you say, I'm reluctant to go to the party. I don't want to, right? Thriving is somebody that is flourishing, that is, you know, doing very good progress, flourishing, growing. Compatible is suitable. Compatible is often used to talk about people when you, you know, say these two people are compatible. So they get along well. They have the same likes and dislikes. And vehement also means strong or intense. So this is our answer. This is the synonym. Got it? So this page, we talked about three words. We talked about invigorate. So for invigorate, guys, you can remember vigor. Vigor is energy, enthusiasm, like Nivedita said. So invigorate is basically to, you know, rejuvenate something, give energy to something. Then we talked about unctuous. Unctuous is behavior that includes too much praise, sort of flattering behavior. And then we talked about fervent. Fervent is something which is intense or passionate, okay, vehement, or, you know, if you know this word, ardent, that can also be a synonym. All right, so let's go ahead. Here are the next three words. So we have jeopardize. Now, I think this is a word that you guys have seen, so you should tell me the answer. Jeopardize. Nivedita, Nicole, what do you think about question number 7? Retreat, heckle, flippant, and endanger. These are the options that we have. So to jeopardize is to put something in danger. D, correct, Nivedita. Very well done. So it's going to be endanger. Retreat is basically to move back or withdraw. Okay. Heckle is... So to interrupt somebody with, you know, very impolitely... So, for example, especially imagine if there's a competition of public speaking somewhere, and when the person is speaking, okay, just to sort of make fun, people start, you know, making these noises, people start making very impolite or very unfriendly remarks. So that is called heckling that person, okay? So somebody is speaking publicly, you interrupt with very unfriendly and very rude remarks, that is heckling. So to interrupt a public speech by rude remarks. And then flippant is something which is not serious, very superficial, okay, frivolous, flippant behavior. So that is flippant. Okay, now the next one, correct, Nicole, correct, Nivedita, well done. The next word is attenuate, and attenuate means to make something weaker. So we can always say that, you know, when you have these peacemaking forces, they try to attenuate the violence. They try to bring the violence down or make it weaker. What do you think the answer should be for question number 8? So we have innovate, we have saw, we have arduous, and relegate. Are there any words that are familiar to you in the 8th one options? See, soar is basically rise or to go, upward. Arduous is something which is difficult, tough. Correct. Well done, Nivedita. Absolutely correct. Yeah. So you can say it was an arduous journey, it was an arduous task, okay? And relegate is to sort of assign an inferior rank or lower or downgrade. That is the meaning of relegate. Now, enervate is often, something that drains your energy. So we say that, I can't bear the heat, it is quite enervating. So the heat is enervating, it drains your energy, so it makes you feel weak, okay? That's how it's a synonym of attenuate, okay? Right, let's go to the next one. Baneful. So baneful is, okay, if I tell you the meaning, I'll tell you the meaning and you'll get the answer also. Baneful is harmful. We can say that the effects of global warming are going to be quite baneful for our health. Okay, harmful or damaging. So I told you the answer. This is the answer. Ardent, as I said, is enthusiastic or passionate. We say I'm an ardent fan of something, right? I'm an ardent supporter of something. Then replenish is can have two meanings. It could be of like fill up, so something that is empty. So you can say, I replenished his drink, filled it up, or even restore something. Okay? And ramble again has two meaning. So ramble can also mean, to walk casually. So when you walk for pleasure, when you take a stroll, that is also ramble. Or it can also mean to talk in a very confused way. So we can say that he went on rambling about something. So there wasn't any link, there wasn't any cohesion or coherence in it, just went on and on. Got it? So all three words here clear, guys? Jeopardize is a very commonly used word, so remember it, okay? So for example, something like, my anger management issues jeopardized my efforts for my promotion, so they put them into danger. Okay, so something like that can be said. Attenuate is to make something weaker. Baneful is harmful. Okay, let's go to the next one. So the last synonym that we have is this. Great, Nicole. Well done. Malinger. So malinger, I'll tell you the meaning, and then you can guess what the synonym is. So it's a verb. And it can be used to talk about people who skip work or duty pretending to be ill. So you know how you don't want to go to office someday and you just call in sick when you're not, when you're actually fine, and you say that, okay, I have fever. Or I have got a cold and I don't want to come. So what you're doing is you're malingering. You are skipping work or avoiding work by pretending to be ill. Okay, now take a look at the options and tell me which option is possible. Looking for a synonym here. Okay, so it's the first option that's the synonym. Docile is somebody who is quite, submissive, easy to control, basically. Okay, if you call somebody docile, that person is very quiet and easy to control. Banal is something which is very ordinary, and that is why, when something becomes boring, you can say it's a banal activity, or banal story. And inconclusive is something which is not final, okay, which is, yeah, so when you say that the result is inconclusive, that means you can't decide anything based on the result. So truant is used for a student who is absent without explanation. Got it? So that's how truant and malinger are synonyms. Okay, so this is all about synonyms, guys. Now we will move on to antonyms. And let me tell you one thing, most of the words that I have included here have been taken from the previous year's question paper. So not as they are, but I have tried to include as many words as possible. So you'll also get to know the level of these question papers. Okay, so the first word here that we have is nescience. Now, always remember, we are looking for the antonyms now. We are looking for words with opposite meaning. And this is something that I always tell students, whenever you are solving vocabulary-based questions in exams, always double-check the instruction, because sometimes just because you are confused about whether you're looking for a synonym or antonym, you can lose marks unnecessarily. So we don't want that. So always double-check the instruction and then go ahead. So, nescience basically means lack of knowledge. Which option? Now, this is very easy. Quickly tell me, Nivedita, Nicole, and who's there? Which option for the first one? Nescience means lack of knowledge. A. That's correct, Nivedita. Well done. Awareness. So basically, nescience means ignorance. Okay, lack of knowledge. So it is the correct option is A. We are looking for an antonym. So yes, generosity is kindness, and miserliness is. See, basically, when we call somebody, yes, Nicole, your answer is also correct. Well done. So, when we call somebody a miser, you mean somebody who is very careful about spending money, like a person who doesn't want to spend money. Okay, if I have to give you like a very simple meaning in Hindi, I would say, you know, when you say kanjoos, somebody is kanjoos, that word is miser. Okay, so miserliness is the extreme desire of saving money. All right. Now, the second one, relinquish. Do you know the word? For example, you know, people who are quite bossy or people who are dominating, for them, it is very difficult to relinquish control. Nivedita is saying D. That's correct, Nivedita. Well done. So relinquish means give up. Okay. Renounce also means give up. But you know, renounce is when you publicly announce, basically, formally declare that you're giving up something. So for example, renouncing a position or renouncing the throne. So you formally declare that you are withdrawing your claim from something. That is called renouncing something. Repudiate is also reject. Okay, so for example, you can say that she was fired because she repudiated the rules, rejected the rules. And relish is enjoy. So relish, retain. Correct, Nivedita. Well done. Absolutely correct. So relish is, you know, for example, I can say I absolutely relish ice cream, so I enjoy it very much. And relish can also be used when you talk how we have chutneys and pickles, right? So there's also a condiment that is made, which is often I think sweet and sour. So that thing can also be called a relish, like a corn relish. Okay, so yeah, all right. Snobbish. Snobbish is somebody who is sort of, you know, kind of rude. And arrogant, elitist. So that is snobbish. What about the antonym? Retain is to maintain or to keep, to continue. Yeah. So these answers were correct. What do you think about snobbish? See, captious. Stocky is somebody who is broad. Okay, stocky is used to talk about somebody's physical, what do you say, physical appearance. And for a person who is broad, you can say he's quite stocky. Okay, and captious is basically somebody who always finds faults, somebody who is very critical. Okay, and uppity is arrogant. So uppity and snobbish can be in a way synonyms. So antonym is modest. Modest is humble, polite. Okay. All right. So are these three words clear? Quickly tell me, and then we'll go to the next three words, guys. Yeah, D. Correct, Nivedita. Your answer is correct. Nicole, is this clear? Great. Well done. So here are the next three words. So the fourth word that we are going to talk about is congruous. So congruous is something which is in agreement to something. Okay, or same as something. So, for example, I can say the conclusion of her research matches, so the conclusion of her research is congruous with the findings or congruous with perhaps the statistical data. So, that means it is in agreement, it's not different, it is the same as the statistical data. Okay, so now this is very easy. Quickly tell me the fourth one. Correct. Nicole, Merita also, I'm sure you've got the answer. Incongruent is incompatible. When something doesn't match. Correct, Nivedita. Correct. See, insensitive is when there are people who do not care about others' feelings or who do not have any concern about others' feelings, you say the person is insensitive. And the last one, hoax is a false news. Okay? Or you can also call it a rumor. Basically, to deceive somebody, to cheat somebody, that is a hoax. So, for example, if I say that, there was a hoax that a particular building was going to be attacked by robbers. Okay, hoax, so it wasn't true. There was no base to it. It wasn't true. It was just a false news. Okay. And the first one, endorse, I think we hear the word a lot of times when we talk about, how celebrities endorse different products. So, basically, endorse is to make a public statement about, so publicly approve something, or to make a public statement about your approval about something. So that's why we say you endorse a product, so that means you approve of the product, okay, you like it, and that's why we say you endorse, because then, when you sort of work in their advertisements and all, so you publicly announce it, you publicly, stated that you approve of the product. So that's why endorsements. Okay, right. Let's go to the fifth question. I'll give you an example. See if you can guess the meaning. So we can say that, when we talk about children, rudimentary education is extremely important in children's lives. It lays the foundation in their lives. What can it be? The fifth one? So rudimentary, guys, is basic or fundamental. Okay, so these are actually synonyms. So the antonym is A, complex. Complex is complicated. Yeah, Nivedita, absolutely correct. Well done. Correct. And this word fraka, it's pronounced as fraka. Fraka is basically a noisy argument or a noisy fight. Okay, so I can make a sentence like, you know, my brother injured himself in a fraka outside his college. So a noisy fight or a noisy argument, that's fraka. Correct, Nicole, well done. And superfluous is unnecessary. So, for example, I can say that the reporter was asking, you know, questions about superfluous information related to the celebrity's life. So, superfluous information, unnecessary information, unnecessary details, you can say. All right. So, let's take a look at the next word, vacillating. Now, vacillating is something that is, you know, that keeps changing. So, for example, I can say that, you know, one of my friends completed her graduation in science, and after that she completed her course in journalism. So she kept vacillating between whether to go for, you know, post-graduation in science or whether to pursue a career in journalism. She kept vacillating between these two options. So, you know, her opinion kept changing. So now you tell me. Looking for an antonym. Resolute. Yes, with Nivedita. Absolutely correct. Resolute is determined. Well done. Absolutely correct. So, dithering is actually a synonym of vacillating. So, it means to be indecisive when you can't decide something. Okay. Uncertain again is a synonym. And otiose is something which... is unnecessary or something that has no practical purpose. And otiose, especially when you, you know, use it for words, for example, you can say that, you know, using these words in an email, these as in, I'm not talking about the words on the screen, but let's say unnecessary words in an email is often otiose. So it's unnecessary. It has no practical purpose. Okay. So, yeah. So here are the three words that we discussed. And on this particular slide, so we talked about congruous. Congruous is something that is in agreement or same as, something that matches something. Rudimentary, basic, fundamental. So remember, rudimentary education, okay, fundamental education. And vacillating keeps fluctuating or changing. Okay, right. Let's go to the next three words that we have. And the first word is fallacious. And I think this word is easy and you'll be able to tell me the answer without me telling you the meaning. Fallacious, what does it mean? You know, you also have the word fallacy. Fallacy, fallacious, almost similar. Yes, Nivedita, well done. It's authentic. Correct. Looking for an antonym, so that is why authentic. So, fallacious is basically something that is false or untrue, fake. Correct, Nicole, well done. Yes. So, erroneous and fallacious are synonyms, okay? Dastardly, it's cruel. So, you know, when you talk about dastardly behavior or dastardly ways of the criminals, cruel or wicked. And adroit is clever or skillful. Okay, so you can say, for example, that he's quite adroit at marketing, very clever at it, very skillful at it. All right, correct, Nivedita, it's fake. Well done. Yes. Now, let's talk about the next one, insurmountable. So, insurmountable is something that is too great to be defeated, too great to be dealt with. Sorry. So, you know, when you say that it was an insurmountable problem or an insurmountable situation, that means it was very difficult and it wasn't possible to overcome the situation or it wasn't possible to deal with it. So, tell me now. You'll be able to answer the question even if you do not know certain words here. Niverita saying A, no, Niverita. It is D, achievable. You're looking for an antonym. Don't forget that. A is actually quite synonymous with insurmountable. So when you say something is unassailable, unassailable means can't be defeated. No, Niverita. Yeah, D. Because we're looking for an antonym, right? See, unassailable would be quite synonymous. Yeah, synonymous with insurmountable. So when you say that something is unassailable, that means it cannot be defeated or cannot be, like, if an argument is unassailable, you can't question that argument or you can't attack it. Okay, so that is, unassailable. The second one, gratuitous is unjustified. Often used about violence, when you say that, you know, it was a gratuitous violence, that means it was unjustified, not necessary, not needed. Okay. And this word, senile is, you know, it's often used for old people. And when you start having problems with your mental ability because of your old age, right? So, for example, see how, you know, when people get old, they start forgetting things. They don't remember or they repeat the same thing. So that is senile behavior. So you can say something like, you know, he decided to live with his senile mother because she needed help. So he decided to live with her. So senile is basically poor mental ability because of old age. Because of old age specifically, okay? It's not a problem otherwise, or if there's any other disorder and because of that you have poor mental ability, you can't use the word senile. Yeah. Okay. Which word, Nivedita? This word you're saying, insurmountable, this is the synonym that you know. Right. Let's go to the next word, guys. So the next word is preconize. So preconize is, you know, commend publicly or announce. This is a little tricky. Nivedita is saying C. That's absolutely correct, Nivedita. Well done. It is C, refrain. So because you're saying, you know, preconize is commend publicly, refrain is to stop somebody from doing something or to be reserved. Okay. Summon is to call or order to come, and adjudicate is to give a formal judgment on something. So, to judge a case basically, okay? Right, okay. Now, let's go to the last antonym that we have, ubiquitous. Correct. Nivedita, you're absolutely correct. By hiding something that may be refrained, correct. Yes, your logic is absolutely correct. Well done. Okay, so the last antonym that we have is ubiquitous, and ubiquitous is something that is found everywhere or present everywhere. Looking for an antonym, remember that, okay? And answer the question. Niverita, Nicole, what do you think about the 10th one? A. That's absolutely correct. Correct. Scarce or rare is the antonym for ubiquitous. You know, when we talk about omnipresent, this is a synonym. So ubiquitous also means present everywhere or found everywhere. Omnipresent also means found everywhere or present everywhere. So these are synonyms. Scarce is the antonym. That's absolutely correct. Pertinent is relevant. Okay. So when we say this is a pertinent issue or this is a pertinent point, a pertinent question, that means it's absolutely relevant. Okay. You can use this word in a group discussion, guys. So, you know, when you're discussing something, if you feel that somebody has raised an absolutely relevant point, you can say that's an absolutely pertinent point. Okay. So just a different word for relevant. And this word conscientious, this word basically means industrious or somebody who works very sincerely, somebody who works very hard, you know, puts in a lot of effort. All right. Correct. Which comes in rare cases, that's why scarce. Correct. Absolutely correct, Nivedita. So, guys, we are done with synonyms, antonyms. Now, we are going to also have a very quick revision of idioms and then we will call it a day. Any questions about these? So always remember, you know, this is something that we have been discussing and I have been telling you. When you use these new words, okay, try and use them in situations that are familiar to you. Otherwise, it'll be difficult to remember them. So for example, omnipresent, you know, how I remember this word is how, you know, the elders in my family say that God is everywhere. So I have associated this word with God. So God is omnipresent. He is everywhere. Okay, or conscientious. So I have a friend who works extremely hard and, you know, he is absolutely like absolutely sincere about his work. So when I think of this word, I think of him. So I remember, you know, the word like that. So try and associate words with people you know or situations you have been in. And it could be movies, it could be series. And that way you'll remember the words much quickly and, you know, you'll remember them for a long time. Okay, all right, so time to revise some idioms, guys, and see some of them you might have seen already because they are very commonly asked, but some of them will be new to you. So let's start. So the first one is Achilles heel. So when you say something is my Achilles heel, now I'll tell you an example. You know, for me, because I was always interested in languages and social sciences, so mathematics has always been my Achilles heel. So what do you think it means? Nivedita, sure. Okay, so what we'll do is, because we are in a flow right now, what we'll do is we will complete these idioms. We are going to talk about 10 idioms. So let's just complete those and then I'll take you back to the first slide. Is that okay? Great. So Achilles heel, guys, what do you think, Nicole and Nivedita? No. I said mathematics. So, I'm saying I was always in love with languages and social sciences. So, mathematics has been my Achilles heel. I always got very low marks in mathematics. So, what does it mean? No. Guys, the answer is B, to be a weakness. Okay, this I actually deliberately put. So, this is to be. When we talk about to fall in love, head over heels with someone, so that is to be completely in love with someone. So Achilles heel, when I say mathematics is my Achilles heel, that means that's my weakness, usually the only weakness. And do you know how this came into existence? So this is actually a story based in the Greek mythology, and this Achilles was basically, somebody told his mother that he was going to die very young, at a very young age. Okay, so his mother took him to a river, and that river, was believed to have magical powers. Okay, so the mother, what the mother did was she dipped him into the river to make him strong, to make him sort of invincible. But when she dipped him into the water, she held him by his heel. Okay, so the entire, the rest of his body got absolutely invincible and very strong and everything, but the heel wasn't dipped into the water of the river, so the heel remained weak. So that's why we say Achilles heel, and that's why this Achilles was, he later became a very, what do you say, great warrior, and he fought and won many wars, and he survived them, but in the end, when he died because of a wound in his heel. Okay, because the rest of his body was invincible, it was absolutely strong, but the heel remained weak. So that's why we say, when we say Achilles heel, that means that's the weakness that somebody has. Okay, so remember the story. Okay, so now the next one is a Herculean task. So I'm not sure if you would agree with me, but if you have ever moved, okay, if you've ever shifted houses from one place to another place, so this moving, packing your stuff and then taking it to from one place to another place, it's a Herculean task. Yes, that's correct. Second is B. Correct. Well done. Now let's talk about the third one. Great, well done. So, a drop in the bucket, how do we use it? I'll use it in a sentence and let me see if you can guess the meaning, guys. So, when this lockdown started and everything, there was sort of people were requested to donate something to help those who are in need. So even I donated a very small amount, and I knew that, whatever I donated, it was just a drop in the bucket. What do you think about the third one? Yes, a very small amount of compared to what is needed. Correct. Very good. Nicole, Nivedita, both your answers are correct. Great. Now the next one is to be a bull in a china shop, and you can actually take it, with literal meaning, and you'll be able to answer the question correctly. Imagine a china shop that is full of very delicate things. Okay, china shop is basically crockery, very delicate sort of things. And if you put a bull into that shop, what will happen? The bull will go on breaking and damaging everything, right? So that's a bull in a china shop. So that this is something that you can use with literal meaning also. Like if you know somebody who is very clumsy, you can say that, don't put him near the delicate glasses or the new expensive glasses, because he's like a bull in a china shop. Or you can also use it sort of metaphorically. For example, one of my friends is very blunt, okay, he doesn't think before speaking. So whenever there is a complicated situation or a delicate situation, we always keep him out of it because he's a bull in a china shop. Because he'll say something and, you know, he'll never be like, you know, politically correct or diplomatic. Careless, yes, correct. So it's option C, correct. Well done. Great. Now the next two idioms. To have a taste of one's own medicine. What do you think this one is? I'm not going to tell you the meaning. Let me see if you can guess. To have a taste of one's own medicine. That's correct. Yes, absolutely correct. Ashwin, well done. Ashwin, where have you been all this while? I've not received any answers from you, but yeah, great. This one is absolutely correct. Great. Nicole, absolutely correct. I'm sure even Nivedita got it correct. So, you know, when do you use it? For example, we can say, see, if we are talking about somebody who deceived a lot of people or who tricked people, cheated them, and if that person is, you know, receiving the same now, like, you know, how you talk about karma, what you do, it comes back to you. You can say now, you know, it's good because he's getting the taste of his own medicine. So he is, you know, experiencing the same bad thing that he did to other people. That's how it is used. Okay, right. The next one is something, when you say something is as good as a chocolate teapot. What could it mean when you say something is as good as a chocolate teapot? A for 6, yes, Nivedita, absolutely correct. Because, you know, you can't have a teapot made of chocolate because two reasons. One, it will melt and, you know, it will spoil the taste of your tea, right? So it's useless. So when you want to say that something is absolutely useless, you can say it is as good as a chocolate teapot. So I'm sure all of you, wherever you stay also, you know, in my city, so there is a area particularly which has all these shops. Okay, it's like a shopping street that we have. So wherever I want to go there, taking a car is as good as a chocolate teapot. It is useless because you get stuck and you can't go ahead. You can't come back. So it's always a good idea to either take a cab and go or take a bike and go. So that's how you can. Yeah, correct, Nivedita. Yes. Okay. Here are the next two. To be saved by the bell. What do you think this is? To be saved by the bell. So guys, to be saved by the bell is used when you escape a difficult situation, like you just managed to escape, like you don't do very well at it. So for example, I can say, you know, when I was a kid once in my school, it's actually the other way, Nivedita. So in my school once, you know, I was going to be punished by the principal. But, you know, just then, you know, the principal's friend came to meet him and I was saved by the bell. So just because of this one small thing, I managed to survive the situation. So when you barely survive, okay, and usually because of something else interrupts and you survive. So you say, you know, you're saved by the bell. Yeah, it's B, correct. So I was, you know, reading about the origins of this idioms, and this one is quite interesting. So I would like to share it with you. You know, where this has come from is how in, you know, earlier days when, see, nowadays when somebody dies, okay, you have medical procedures or you have sort of instruments to confirm that the person is really dead. Okay, but sometimes sometimes when the medical science was not that advanced, sometimes people would be alive, but they would be declared dead, you know, by mistake, by perhaps ignorance. So what these people would do was, you know, when the coffin was put in the ground, the person had something like a bell attached to their, I think, tied to their wrist. Okay. And then there would be somebody else sitting outside for one night after the person was buried. So if the person who was supposed to be dead, if the person moved, the bell would ring. Okay. And that is why, you know, the person who was outside would come to know that, okay, you know, if the bell is ringing, that means this person is alive because it's tied to his wrist. Okay. So that's why saved by the bell. So, but now we use it when we talk about like just barely managing to survive a situation. Okay, let's go to the next one, which is to go out on a limb. What do you think this is? What do you think this one is, to go out on a limb? Eighth, maybe B. No, it is A. Okay, so basically, I can say that, you know, everyone in my office was in favor of, you know, introducing new working shifts or introducing a new policy, and I didn't want to go out on a limb by opposing it. Okay, so I didn't want to go out on a limb, as in I didn't want to have an opinion which will not be. So when you go out on a limb, you have an opinion or you express an opinion which nobody supports, which is not supported by others. It's A, correct. Yeah, great. And here are the last two idioms that we are going to discuss for today. So to steal someone's thunder. Now this is a very commonly used idiom, and I'm sure if you watch English movies and series, you have heard it many times in their conversations. To steal someone's thunder. Yes, Ashwin is correct here. So to steal someone's thunder is to take praise or success away from someone by doing something that they were supposed to do. It was getting very long, so I didn't complete it. So I'll explain this to you. See, for example, I can say that, you know, in a particular family, like let's say in my family, so I got a promotion and I wanted to tell it to my parents. And I was very excited about it. I came home, I told my parents that I got a promotion. But at the same time, my sister announced that she was getting married. So she stole my thunder. So, you know, all the attention and all the praise that was coming my way, but she gave them a bigger news. Okay, so everything was like directed towards her. So that is called to steal somebody's thunder. Okay, so it's C. Yes. And the last one, an arm and a leg. So, you know, the last one is often used as to cost an arm and a leg. So, for example, I can say last week I bought a laptop that cost me an arm and a leg. So, what do you think it means? No, Ashwin, this was just an example. It is not real. But anyway, thank you. Okay. Something, yeah, extremely expensive, correct. Yes. So when you want to say that something is extremely expensive, you can say I paid an arm and a leg for it, or it cost me an arm and a leg. Okay. Yeah, very expensive. Yes. Right, guys, so we are done for today. And I hope this helps. We just had a quick revision of vocabulary and idioms. And from tomorrow onwards, we are going to start talking about reading comprehension. Okay. So if you have any questions about this, you can ask me. And I hope all of you will take up the Plus subscription, because on the Plus subscription, you will also get to solve a mock test series. You will also get to see the leaderboard, and that will be like very encouraging for all of you, because you're very active learners and you keep giving answers during the sessions. And you'll also get a chance to interact with your faculty much more, and many other facilities like that. To install, to subscribe to an Academy Plus, you just need to install this app on your phone. And once you've installed it, go for the Plus option, select your course, which is CAT, and then you just need to open the app every day and start learning. And I have already recommended you two plans. Nivedita, I remember about your first slide, okay? I'll just go back after I finish this slide. So I've already recommended you this 1 year plan or a two or the 2 year plan. So make sure that you subscribe to an Academy Plus, and also please use this code. This is my code, Apurva, so that you get a 10% off. So before we go ahead, guys, I think Nivedita had requested that she wanted to see the first slide. Yes, here, Nivedita. So this was the first one. Oh, hi, Nivedita. Okay. Great. I'm so glad that you're attending the sessions every day. So yeah, so this was the first one that you wanted to see, right? The slide. Do you have any questions about this, or you just wanted to take a look at the words? Yeah, so the first one, Nivedita, it's, stentorian is a loud or powerful voice. That's the meaning of the word. So when you say something is stentorian, it means loud or powerful. So we are looking for a synonym, right? Now, see, rhythmic is something that has a specific beat. Or, when you say a rhythmic song, for example, something that happens at a regular interval sound-wise. Euphonious is used for something which is pleasant, a pleasant sound. Okay. Another word which is quite similar to euphonious is mellifluous. So, sweet, smooth sound. Okay. Blaring is again something which is very loud or harsh. So, often used to talk about, when we say the blaring siren of a vehicle. And subdue is to overcome a situation. So subdue is completely out. Now we're looking for a synonym. So this would be the synonym, option C. Got it? All right. Yeah, great. Okay. So, as I said, we are done for the day. So please take up the Unacademy Plus subscription, guys, and please use this code Apurva, so that you'll get a 10% off when you subscribe to Unacademy Plus. And Unacademy also has some excellent courses on these competitive exams that you can see on your screens. So if anybody you know is preparing for these exams, or they just want to get to know about these exams, please recommend these courses to them. Ask them to check out these courses. And last but not the least, do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel at Unacademy CAT for MBA. Please like these videos, share them with your friends, press the bell icon so that you get notifications every time a session is announced. And also join our Telegram group at CAT for MBA. You'll get the PDF of the sessions that you are attending also there. All right. So that's it for today, guys. We are done for the day. And I'll see you tomorrow at 6 p.m. So till then, take care. Bye.